Recently, I was asked the question, does it really prevent heartworm transmission when you apply repellents? So as I thought about that question, I realized that I had several other questions. And I'd like for you to think about these three questions for the next few minutes. Are we missing something in our prevention, heartworm prevention program? Could we do a better job in preventing the disease? Could we be using a multimodal approach to heartworm prevention? I think we would all agree that we have had excellent microcyclic lactone preventives for the past several decades. They're extremely effective, they're easy to use, they're safe, and they're relatively inexpensive. But we still have a problem with the lack of compliance. It's still a key issue, and we need to continue to address it. Resistance has emerged. I think we would all agree that it's been detected and it's been confirmed, but we are still lacking a lot of information, particularly about the spread of resistance throughout the country. Now, heartworm is transmitted by mosquitoes, and I think it's interesting to realize that more than 70 different species of mosquitoes are capable of developing the microfilaria to the third stage infective larvae. I think this is one of the main reasons that we have such a high prevalence of heartworm disease in so many warm, humid climates throughout the world. There are two reasons. First, dogs and other canids are so highly susceptible to heartworm disease. And also, there's so many different species of mosquitoes that can transmit the disease. Preventives inhibit the disease development, but they do not prevent infection. The animal is infected before the preventive kills the larvae. Preventives kill the larvae that accumulate between the treatments. So should we consider the use of repellents and insecticides as complementary measures in a heartworm prevention program? If we want to consider repellency, what should we expect from the repellent? First of all, repellents should block the heartworm transmission. And if it blocks transmission, it will subsequently block infection. Now, an interesting thing about the repellency is that it makes no difference whether the heartworm is resistant or susceptible to the microcyclic lactone. If the mosquito is carrying the resistant worm, the repellents repel the mosquito. If it's carrying the susceptible worm, it also repels the mosquito. So we know we have resistance emerging, and we know that it will be several years before we have a new molecule as for prevention. So we should be able to use repellents to fill in the gap and also delay the development and the spread of resistance. Now, the World Health Organization put out a pamphlet, which I show you here. It's a pamphlet for people in countries where there's a major problem with different vector-borne diseases. They mentioned several diseases here: malaria, dengue, yellow fever, and Japanese encephalitis. These are all transmitted by mosquitoes. But I'd like to add two filarial diseases: lymphatic filariasis, transmitted by mosquitoes, and also onchocerciasis, or river blindness, which is transmitted by black flies. So this pamphlet encourages people to do simple measures to help prevent and protect themselves from these different parasites that are vector-borne. There are several things they can do, and I can mention just a few of these here. They can use screens in their houses. They can apply topical repellents. They can wear light-colored clothing that mosquitoes are not quite as likely to be attracted to light colors as dark colors. They can use the bed netting, particularly if it's embedded with an insecticide. And they can get rid of different bodies of water where the mosquitoes can breed. So I think we should consider this type of approach to heartworm prevention. So what is some of the research evidence about mosquitoes, transmission of heartworms, and dogs? Well, one of the studies that I happened to catch my attention was a study by Frank and his co-authors in 2012. They were working with doing a study with vector 3D and Aedes aegypti mosquitoes, and they found a high level of repellency and insecticidal activity with use of this product. First, they showed a high anti-feeding activity or repellency, and that was equal to or greater than 87% for 28 days. They also showed the product had a high insecticidal efficacy, and that was equal to or greater than 93% for 28 days. Now, repellents are, some of them are very good, but they're not all equal, so we need to keep that in mind as we go along. Now, what is some of the evidence of the use of repellents and insecticides for heartworm prevention? Well, the first one I want to mention is blocking the transmission of microfilaria to the mosquito. We recently conducted a study on this, and I'll give you a few slides showing some of that data. Also, we have an ongoing study that's giving some very interesting and encouraging results. And we expect that the product will block the infection of dogs with the infective larvae. That is, prevent the transmission of the infective larvae from the mosquito. So this is just an outline of the study. We used two groups of dogs. We had a treated group, treated with vector 3D. We had a control group that was not treated. We treated the dogs on day zero. 7 days before treatment, we exposed the dogs to these uninfected mosquitoes just to make sure that the mosquitoes would bite these particular dogs. And then on day 7, 14, 21, and 28 after treatment, we exposed the dogs again to the mosquitoes. And we collected these data that I show below this, but I would give this to you in some photographs in the next few slides. So to do this study in the laboratory, we had one treated group and one control group. The dogs were exposed on the days that I mentioned. And we, in this particular case, we deliberately chose our most resistant strain of heartworm in our laboratory. And everyone that works with heartworm disease knows that JYD34 is a pretty resistant strain. We also used Aedes aegypti that we have in our laboratory. Now, prior to the exposure, we did a microfilaria count on the dogs. We anesthetized the dogs. We put them in the container you see here. We released the mosquitoes into the container with the dog. And this is a mosquito-proof container, of course. And we exposed each of the dogs to mosquitoes for about an hour. Here you see some mosquitoes that are attempting to bite this dog on the left. During the time the mosquitoes were exposed, we collected about 20 mosquitoes that were feeding on the dogs, that had fed on the dogs. Now, of course, some of the treated dogs, the mosquitoes were not feeding. We couldn't collect that many. But in most of the dogs, or the control dogs particularly, we were able to collect 20 mosquitoes. Now, we dissected those 20 mosquitoes from each dog individually. You see the red blood in the midgut of the mosquito here. So we teased that midgut, released the blood onto a slide. We stained it, and with GIMSA, and then we counted the number of microfilariae that the mosquitoes had taken up. Now, the ones that we did not remove from the container, we put them into an insectary. We kept them for 16 days to allow the microfilariae to develop to the L3 stage. And then we dissected these mosquitoes individually to get a count of the L3s. So this is the results. As I mentioned earlier, we had two groups. We had the control group. Had a lot of mosquitoes were able to feed on the control group. In fact, over 500 mosquitoes in total, while only a few mosquitoes were able to feed on the treated dogs. You see, 22 fed on the treated dogs. Now, this gives us an anti-feeding or repellency value of 95 to 100% for these four different exposures. Also, for looking at insecticidal activity, you can see that a lot of the mosquitoes in the control group were able to feed, and there were some unfed ones, a lot of them, whereas there were only a few in the treated group. And we had an insecticidal activity of 95.5% to 100% for this time period. Now, if you look at the value for the number of microfilariae that we found per mosquito, the controls had a lot of microfilariae. We did not dissect the 22 mosquitoes that fed on the Vector 3D treated dogs. We decided to hold them for survival to see if they had infective larvae 16 days later. Now, but we dissected the other mosquitoes from the control group, and you see we had a range of 6 to 38 and an average of 12.3 per mosquito. And there were no larvae in the treated group. So we had an anti-spreading effect of greater than 99%. So if we look at the summary of this data, you can see that repellency was greater than 98%. Insecticidal efficacy was greater than 97%. We blocked the development of the microfilaria to the third stage larvae in greater than 99.9% of the mosquitoes. We blocked the ability of the infected mosquitoes to transmit the third stage larvae to other animals. And this was greater than 99.9%. Now, so for conclusion, we can say these insecticidal repellents block heartworm transmission from dogs to mosquitoes and from mosquitoes to dogs, and that's by repelling and killing the mosquitoes. So they would be a critical component of a multimodal approach to heartworm prevention and also aid in the spread of resistant heartworm. Thank you very much.